Phones are on so that our folks in the virtual world can participate in our dialogue and session. So with that, I would ask my colleague, Trustee Morales, if you would please convene the Committee on University and Faculty Personnel.
Thank you, Chair Monville. The Committee on University and Faculty Personnel is called to order. Unless there are any objections, the minutes of the September 2015 meeting stand approved. Before we begin discussion, we would like to hear from our speakers. We have Molly Talcott, Kevin Ware, Doug Domingo Forrest speaking this morning. Each, if you could identify yourself, you have 3 minutes each.
Hi, good morning. Faculty are alarmed about the proposed change in policy on lifting caps on new president's salaries. And two main concerns underlie our objection. The first is that this move suggests that you think that there are not enough qualified and talented people who would serve as presidents for a public service level salary. We think you're wrong, and the governor also thinks you're wrong. This is a misguided decision that neglects the reality that CSU presidents are public servants, not CEOs. Rather than enhancing your ability to pay presidents private institutions, CEO-style salaries and perks, we urge you to recruit people that don't insist that they be paid twice what our own governor makes in order to be willing to take a job as a campus president in the CSU. Our second concern pertains to the history of the implementation of salary caps for newly hired presidents. This limit was established to impose prudence on this board after public outrage exploded over the administration's inability to use good judgment as a public institution in setting presidential salaries. On a final note, we are concerned once again about the disparate treatment and logic that lie behind your recruitment of faculty versus your recruitment of presidents. Allow me to confirm what you might imagine. A plan to establish a new norm of measuring the average salary of CSU campus presidents and then adding an additional 10% onto that for new recruits will not sit well among faculty who are not being told that their salaries too will be bumped up to an average plus an additional 10% on top of that. Once again, it appears that the CSU is fretting the most about the salaries of those in the system who need raises the least. This is not a balanced approach, and if implemented, it will reflect both a lack of institutional memory and an unwise use of state resources. Thank you.
Good morning, Kevin Ware, Chair of Bargaining for CFA, Professor of Sociology at CSU Sacramento. In the last few years, the state of California has invested far more in the CSU than the CSU has been willing to invest in those of us who make student success possible, the faculty and the staff. Over the past few years, the governor and the legislature have increased the CSU budget by double-digit percents, just 10% this year. Nevertheless, you've stubbornly continued to offer us only 2%. We know that you have the resources. What you fail to understand, apparently, is that deciding what you think is fair in compensating your employees before the bargaining process is even undertaken is not bargaining in good faith. It's putting the cart before the horse. Indeed, we went back and we looked at the law that governs this process, and in HERA, section 3572B, it says, the duty to meet and confer in good faith requires the parties to begin negotiations prior to the adoption of the final budget for the ensuing year, sufficiently in advance of the adoption date, so that there is adequate time for agreement to be reached or for the resolution of an impasse. That's the law. deciding to pay us 2% a year and a half ago, before the bargaining process even began, is not in accordance with HERA. We think that you should follow the law. We think that you should be fair. And we think that you should fairly compensate your employees and bargain in good faith. We look forward to that sometime in the future. Thank you.
Is that it? Okay. Well, thank you very, very much. Thank you to all speakers. Anybody else here who's been called? I only had three. Okay. Yeah. So, thank you all. Now I want to introduce agenda item one. It's an information item regarding the annual report, vice president compensation, executive relocation, and executive transition. Vice Chancellor Lamb will present the item. Lori?
Thank you, Trustee Morales. We're pleased to update the Board of Trustees on Vice President compensation, executive relocation, and executive transitions. Current trustee policy requires the Chancellor to report in open session on three items: vice presidential compensation decisions that have taken, executive relocation expenses, and executive transition programs. These elements are reported in the materials in your packet in the same way they've been provided for many years. We did agree to begin providing additional compensation information for more context, and we've done that at the last several board meetings. The first report in the materials relates to vice presidential salary changes. Presidents have authority to make these decisions, and the chancellor reviews and approves the same. All decisions for new hires or for changes in an existing vice president's salary meet the policies and requirements of the CSU. Those actions are reported in the tables attached for actions that took place from September 1st, 2014 through August 31st, 2015. With regard to relocation, we had three individuals receive relocation costs as they assumed their new responsibilities, and those costs are reflected in the report. All costs were in compliance with CSU policies. With regard to executive transition programs, we have three different transition programs in place. These programs have been modified over time by the board to adjust the program and ensure that there is valid work being performed during the transition year. The current program requires continued work within the CSU for eligibility. Each executive is eligible for the programs depending upon when they began their service with the CSU, and these are contractual obligations that cannot be changed. Currently, two individuals are in transition assignments. We reported last month about Dr. Mo Kayomi entering the executive transition program. And you will see that Dr. Michael Ortiz will be finishing his transition assignment on December 31st of 2015. Trustee Morales, that concludes my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Well, thank you, Lori. Agenda item number two is an action item on proposed policy on compensation. Chair Monville has asked to address this issue, followed by Chancellor White and Vice Chancellor Lamb. Chair Monville.
Thank you, Trustee Morales, and I appreciate the opportunity to be a part of this important discussion appreciate the board's indulgence. Before we get into the discussion on this topic, let me be very, very clear. Contrary to what has been said publicly or that I've seen in other forums, there's nothing on the agenda today that changes any president's salary. We're not changing salaries today. We're talking about a go-forward policy, and I think that's a very important distinction that I want to make sure is clear for the public. You know, I've throughout this process and in my tenure on the board in trying to tackle this process and this issue and try to find common ground and a reasonable approach moving forward, I've emphasized what I hope are common points of understanding that all of us as trustees can agree upon. One, that quality programs are essential for the public benefit that we provide. Quality programs rely on quality people, and quality people are recruited and retained through fair compensation, and that is for all of our employees. During the recession, the CSU set a policy on presidential salaries that also called for a reevaluation, which is what we are doing now, particularly at this important time as we enter five presidential searches. We've also seen recent media, like the San Jose Mercury News coverage, discussing our challenges in hiring presidents, particularly women and candidates of color. It is publicly known that our salaries create impediments in these areas, and I know this is something that this board is deeply addressing. That said, we've also received feedback from key stakeholders that moving too quickly might be sending the wrong signal. Let me be clear. We never intended, nor have the discussions of the policies put before you, changed current salaries. But we do want, I believe, a rational framework for this process. Nonetheless, we've heard these concerns, and I ask the Chancellor and staff to further refine a policy that accounts for these concerns and feedback. We do this in a show of good faith to stakeholders, that we are comfortable with a measured approach that brings incremental change, but retains the control of this board and public accountability to controlling presidential salaries. As such, I'm proposing an amendment to the Board of Trustees policy on compensation from that which is different from that's in the materials today. I'd ask staff to distribute that if they would for your review at this time. The amendment I'm proposing in this policy retains the limitation on presidential salaries to the incumbent's salary plus 10%. What it does eliminate is the use of foundation dollars to do so. I'm happy to say that through discussions with key stakeholders in the Department of Finance, this is a policy that they too support. I believe that now, what is before us in this amendment accomplishes the goals that we set out for our board. To be able to attract, recruit, and retain the highest quality leadership for our institutions, I think this policy also works to establish consistent and fair methodologies for us to use moving forward that apply to all of our employee groups across the CSU. With that, I would ask, as my colleagues are able to review this amendment, I would ask the Chancellor if he has any comments.
Well, thank you, Chair Monville, and I support the amendment you have put in front of the Board of Trustees. We need a change in this policy, not just for our presidents, but for all of our employees. We need a rational framework moving forward to evaluate all of our compensation decisions. As you know, Vice Chancellor Lamb and I have been working hard to share with you our challenges in this area over the last several meetings. This new amended policy will help provide a framework for beginning to address these challenges in a meaningful way. It's also a step in the right direction to address presidential salary setting into the future while maintaining the existing cap that provides some assurance that presidential salaries will be handled in a measured and thoughtful manner. I heard your comments at the last board meeting about this policy, and I've heard the interest from other stakeholders. We have taken those comments seriously, and I believe the amended policy before you is appropriate and reasonable. I now turn the presentation over to Vice Chancellor Lamb, who will provide more details. Lori?
Thank you, Chancellor White and Chair Monville. I'm pleased to present information on the amended compensation policy proposed by Chair Monville. We believe this is a policy that addresses all CSU employees in a fair and consistent manner, as well as provides a reasonable path forward on presidential salary setting. As stated by Trustee Monville, we're not asking the board to change any salaries today. We're simply establishing the mechanisms to take appropriate salary actions in the future for all of our employees. Of the compensation challenges we face and that we have talked about in the last several meetings. Those challenges include the lack of salary competitiveness compared to our peers and variations in competitiveness depending upon the employee groups. All of our employee groups are affected. Some are more competitive than others, and none are as competitive as we would like them to be. We have the lack of a thorough review of total compensation, for which we are moving forward to conduct a review. Cost of living differences across California, which affect our campuses differently and create particular challenges. We have increased health care and retirement costs and more. We spend roughly 59% of the total CSU budget on compensation, and it consequently deserves significant attention. This is why we need the foundation of a sound policy to help guide our decisions moving forward. We are proposing such a policy for your consideration today. I want to begin by clarifying the history of the compensation policies that existed. The board first adopted a compensation policy in September 2007. Slide 2 describes the policy in general terms regarding the goal, general issues of fairness, and comparisons with CPEC, which is the California Post-Secondary Education Commission, which closed its doors in 2011, so that was not feasible any longer to use that data for comparison purposes. Thereafter, in May 2012, the Board's Special Committee on Presidential Selection and Compensation recommended and the trustees adopted a policy on presidential compensation. The next slide describes that policy in general terms regarding the goal, again, principles of fairness and maintaining a tiered list of institutions. It also provided certain limits on presidential salary setting, in particular, one, that the successor's salary paid with state funds shall not exceed the previous incumbent's base pay, and two, if necessary, the previous salary can be exceeded by up to 10%, but it needed to be paid with foundation dollars. The policy also provided for reexamination. So after hearing the conversation and input at the last meeting from this board and additional feedback from stakeholders, we now review the amended policy that Chair Monville has circulated. The new single policy has many similarities to the old policies in that it retains the same goal, retains the focus on fairness and fiscal responsibility, and retains the use of appropriate market comparisons to evaluate competitiveness. This helps to ensure we evaluate all employee compensation using the same criteria, similar methodologies, and adhere to the same standards. The new policy continues to articulate requirements for compliance with applicable laws, consistency with policies, and respect for our collective bargaining agreements and processes. It also includes a section dealing with presidential compensation that provides minor changes in the administration of presidential salary setting that will help us achieve the goal of attracting and retaining high-quality leaders for our campuses. The following are the key components to the new section on presidential salary setting. The components are, one, the elimination of the use of foundation dollars, and two, retaining the cap at 10% above the incumbent's salary. At our last meeting, we believe we heard general agreement to eliminate the use of foundation funds to supplement salaries. The use of these supplemental foundation dollars has created unintended and unforeseen inequities and has created potential conflicts of interest for our presidents who serve on the foundation boards. Retaining the 10% cap over the incumbent's salary, but allowing the use of state funds, will assist the board in beginning to address salary setting for incoming presidents, while also providing assurance that presidential salaries will not escalate unnecessarily. It's worth pointing out that setting this cap at 10% above the incumbent's salary does not mean that all initial salaries will be at the maximum level. Initial salaries can be at any point below the maximum. From my review of salary setting under Chancellor Wright, he's been very conservative, and I would expect this pattern to continue. In addition, the board always retains the right to approve or disapprove the salary of a president. In conclusion, we support the amended policy proposed by Chair Monville. This new policy updates and retains what is good from the prior versions of the policies, using the same goal, the emphasis on fairness, compliance, competitiveness, etc. And the new policy effectively addresses presidential salary setting by removing the use of foundation funds and retaining the cap on initial salaries for presidents. So this leads me to our recommendation. Chancellor White, Chair Monville, and I have looked deeply into this issue and have tried hard to address the concerns we heard last month, as well as concerns from other stakeholders. We recommend adoption of the policy on compensation as it is set forth in the amendment proposed by Chair Monville. We also recommend that, for clarity, this policy should supersede other existing policies on this topic. With that, Chair Morales, I'm happy to answer any questions and look forward to the discussion.
Any questions? Yes, Lupe.
Thank you. I'm just looking at the revised policy. One question, and I don't know, Lori, if this is appropriate for you. We state in the revised materials, revised policy, that the successor president's salary will not exceed the incumbent salary by more than 10%. In the materials that were previously distributed to us, it had some further guidance on the fact that the 10% would be based on extraordinary circumstances, knowledge and or experience or ability to contribute and advance the university's mission. So is there a reason we didn't include that in the revised policy?
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. The original policy was actually those on the 10%. That's the difference. This actually retains the 10% as the maximum.
Right, but I understand that what we're trying to do is say we're going to rely on, we're going to look to the incumbent salary, which again, not guaranteed as where we start, depending on the experience, it might be less. But we're saying that it's going to be at a base of the, potentially of the incumbent salary, and we might consider doing more.
Correct.
It's not that we will always do more, but we might consider it. And so I guess the question is, in considering doing more in those instances where we think that it's appropriate, what is there, I mean, because I think it's helpful guidance to say that if we think we need to do more, we have some factors to consider so that at least when we do feel we should do more, we're operating off of a consistent framework that we can all say, here are the criteria we use to make that determination. I just think it's helpful to maintain that language.
So I would say that one of the things we tried to do in this amended policy was to keep the language as consistent with the old policy to provide assurance we weren't trying to do anything massively different other than changing the source of funds. However, I think that any time that the chancellor comes forward with a recommendation of something above the incumbent salary for that 10%, he's going to need to provide a justification to the board for that purpose that would be consistent with the language you're referring to.
Okay. Now, I don't know if it was Trustee Kimball or Taylor who had their hands up.
Kimball.
Yes. Vice Chancellor Kimball. Lamb, I had a question about the salary will be indexed. So for those presidents who are currently receiving the supplemental pay, the current salary would then be the pay with the supplement and then 10%, the ability to go 10% above that. And we would not be receiving the foundation. I mean, we're asking to eliminate the foundational dollars, right?
That's correct, Trustee Kimball. We would combine the combined salary would be the benchmark for the incumbent salary and then move forward if there was a reason to go beyond that incumbent salaries with a maximum of 10%. Going forward, we would not be adding any additional foundation dollars to any presidential compensation.
Okay. But we would be keeping that base that exists now with the foundational dollars.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Trustee Fagan?
It's a quick question. Since we just received this, it's kind of hard to know exactly what the changes are without a red line example. So just for future reference, I think we would have appreciated maybe having it emailed to us in advance so we could at least take a look at it. What exactly are the changes on this amendment in words that are different from the existing policy? Is it just the reference to the foundation, or is there anything else that's different?
Thank you, Trustee. The changes, there's one change that we added in the body of the policy language to include reference to using the percent of Pell eligible students as a criteria for developing the comparison institutions. Since that was an issue raised by the Department of Finance, we wanted to clarify that we continue to use that criteria in developing those comparison institutions. That's the only change in the body of the policy. The only other changes were under the previous policy, there was a section on executive compensation that's different than what you see today. That presidential compensation, those two paragraphs are replacing the language in the original policy. Those are the only changes.
And the substance of those changes you've already described?
Correct.
What about the last paragraph about the chancellor's authority? Was that in the previous policy?
Yes, it was.
One other comment, Doug, and I appreciate your comment. Obviously, part of the challenge we have in doing, conducting business in open and transparent fashion is sending things out in advance would have been a violation of Bagley-Keene, and I was obviously mindful of that. So certainly you have my apologies, but I wanted to make sure we were operating within the policies and procedures and laws that govern this body. And so I recognize that requires us to do some work here as a body, but I think that's the appropriate way in which we should conduct business.
I understand. So I have just a couple quick comments. I'm not against this idea, and I certainly understand the desire to eliminate the, and I assume the chancellor will give us a little bit of background on the inherent conflict of interest issues that are there for the presidents who get foundation money and trying to eliminate that, and that's apparently a real driving force here. There's some irony, I think, in that, as far as I can tell, the reason the existing policy is in effect was as a reaction to dissatisfaction by the legislature and others about salary setting in 2011, 2012, and that the 10% for foundation money was a effort to make it easier to do that, but without tax dollars. And somehow that was more politically palatable. And what's interesting is now we're sort of reversing that to make it easier to do it with tax dollars than to do it with foundation money. My concern is that what this is all about is making it easier to do that. It is making it easier to give that 10% because of the restrictions on the foundation money and the reluctance to do that. So I think we should recognize that this may have an intent. And I understand that we're not saying we're raising it at all, that we're not assuring anybody we're giving one penny more than the incumbent salary. But when you take an action to make something easier to do, the thought is there that you may want to do that. And I would hope that the chancellor is not getting the message that we are automatically agreeing that these extra dollars are reasonable. Since the time I've been on the board, we have not hired anybody at one penny more than the amounts their predecessors have had. And as far as I can tell, and I think the chancellor agrees, and we all agree, we've gotten some pretty good people. And I think a lot of people believe that when you get 300,000 or 325 or 350 with a car and a house, that, you know, plus the psychic income of having a great job of respect, that this is pretty good. And public service is not there to, you know, necessarily get rich. Yesterday, we heard from Karen talking about different initiatives that are being filed for petitions to be circulated around California, and one is to tax the wealthy. And the definition in that proposed initiative of wealthy is $300,000. So, you know, let's keep in mind what the rest of the world thinks in terms of dollars. When I was, I've said this before, but at my confirmation hearing for this job, the very first question and the very first concern of the Senate Rules Committee was over presidential compensation. And they seemed to be pleased with the idea that I thought we were being fine with existing amounts. So public service and all those issues, plus to have more presidents getting more money when we are at a point where we're telling the faculty that they can't have more than 2%. And yet we're looking at the highest paid people in our system to try to attract them by giving them potential raises that might equal the annual salary of some of our lowest paid people. You know, that's not a good message. And we heard yesterday that Sacramento people in the legislature and elsewhere are concerned about these issues. The speaker mentioned it. I think we should be really cognizant that this is not a blank check, that we're not automatically agreeing to this. The chancellor, when he does these negotiations, does not give presidents, potential presidents, and I would hope that the search firm people do not give a message of too much optimism that there's going to be a whole bunch of money, more money than the predecessor there. I should say it's going to be difficult if a negotiated salary of a high amount is, and the chancellor is going to do this, and I totally trust him, and I think we all do, to make the best deal possible. But it's going to be difficult if he has, tentatively agreed to a higher amount that we might otherwise agree to come back and say, no, you can't do that after he's had those discussions. So I think there's some red flags here. But all that being said, I understand the desire to have the flexibility. We do need to be in charge and have those capabilities. The foundation conflicts are serious and real. So, I'm very conflicted on this, but I'm not going to oppose it.
Trustee Taylor and then Trustee Garcia.
Thank you. A couple of questions and some broader philosophical comments. Lori, help me. So we're eliminating the possibility that foundations can contribute to the salary of presidents, but it's not mentioned anywhere in here. By virtue of the fact it's not mentioned, are they prohibited from doing it?
The prior policy specifically said that if you were going to use 10%, it had to be with foundation funds. This policy just says you can go up to 10% and is silent on funds, meaning that presumptively it could be state dollars. I suppose there's also that possibility in the offing that, for example, Lieutenant Governor Newsom last meeting, maybe there is going to be an exception to that. That wouldn't be what we want to do, but it's silent on it to say that it doesn't have to be with foundation funds.
Okay. All right. I'm not philosophically opposed personally to using foundation dollars to compensate presidents, but I can appreciate that it creates an appearance of a conflict potentially.
Correct.
And as you know, sometimes in this world, appearance is reality. So I'm perfectly fine with that approach, and I think that's something we can live with. So I'm on the search committee for the CSU CI president.
Yes.
As you know, we were up in Camarillo on a beautiful day.
Yes.
And really enjoyed the open forum, you know, where people came and dozens of people making comments over a period of about an hour. I think those of us who were sitting in the shade enjoyed it maybe a little bit more than those who were blinded by the sun. But, you know, one of the things that struck me, I think, is when you compile all the comments that came in open forum, it's almost, you know, if you were able to meet all those criteria, you're looking for a Superman or Superwoman, right? And it struck me that I'm sure there are leaders out there who are, in fact, Superman or Superwoman, but we are just one of dozens of institutions around this country who are searching for college, university presidents and chancellors. But a lot of those other folks who are searching for them as well, they're a lot more well-heeled than we are. And they can afford to pay much more than we can afford to pay. And they're willing to pay much more than we can afford to pay. And I worry that, frankly, we've created certain constraints in our search process that long-term, philosophically, put us on the losing end of an ever-escalating salary game. And I think, philosophically, we are competing in an arena where, frankly, it's tough for us to win. And I would encourage, you know, I don't know if it's so much a policy on compensation, but I think it's a more of a philosophical approach for the chancellor. As we go forward, we've made certain constraints, I think, Chancellor, in the way we approach our searches by, to be perfectly blunt, limiting ourselves to people who have PhDs, people who've taught, people who have had tenure, and people who come from an academic background. I believe these are great jobs. These aren't just great jobs because you're making 300 grand and you're getting a house and you're getting a carpet, right? These are legacy jobs. These are opportunities to leave an imprint in a way that very few people in the entire world will ever have. And I think we need to look not just for somebody who's the best academic leader. We need to look for somebody who's the best leader and somebody who's got a passion for public higher education, who happens to come from whether it be the corporate sector, the labor sector, the NGO sector. We should broaden our searches because I think these are the kind of jobs where somebody would look at this and say, oh my gosh, the chance to leave a mark like that and get 300 grand, what a deal. So let's not put ourselves in a position where we're trying to go after Superman or Superwoman and competing with a lot of other wealthy colleges and universities. Let's broaden our searches to people who maybe don't have the traditional background, but do have the skill set by which they can lead a campus and lead an institution as complex as our campuses. Because I think ultimately you'll find, by virtue of the fact you expand that base, you put the institution in a better negotiating position when it comes to this touchy issue of compensation. So I don't know if that's so much a comment for you, Lori, or a comment for Chancellor White, but I think long-term we need to approach this a little bit differently, because there are very talented people out there who I think would frankly fall all over themselves for a chance to take on a opportunity to lead one of our campuses.
Thank you.
I would say that I appreciate your comments completely, and I would say that that approach also helps us broaden the type of diversity we'll see in our applicant pools, which is obviously a commitment that this system holds strong and dear, is to look and recruit and hopefully attract and retain the most diverse leaders, the most diverse faculty, the most diverse staff that we possibly can. So the approach you're describing also enables that particular commitment that we have as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Trustee Garcia, you want to speak? Trustee Eisen?
Thank you. So I appreciate Trustee Fagan's comment about how we don't have them side by side and can't really track otherwise, because in doing so, I see a bunch of small differences that may or may not be meaningful. I'm not sure. For example, when we talk about the tiering that we're going to do and finding comparative institutions, in the original policy, we talked about guiding our discussions by reference to the mean of those comparative, and now we've added the median, and maybe that's just, you know, somebody thinking median makes more sense than mean, and but things like, you know, we're going to look at the individual's reputation. We used to say the individual's reputation for national policy leadership, and now that language has dropped out. So there are a lot of little pieces like that. We used to say we're going to look at their effectiveness with respect to executive applicable experience, and the word executive has dropped out. But I'm not really sure if there is a reason that the verbiage has changed and whether any of it is significant. I mean, there are many ways to say the same thing. But I do want to be sure that we're not, you know, changing something subtly in a way that the rest of us don't fully appreciate. Maybe that wasn't, you know, that's not what we're doing at all. I did notice, though, that in the old policy, there is no discussion about the chancellor having the authority to negotiate recommended salaries and then present that to a board for approval. I think it should be approval or disapproval, right, technically. But that language wasn't in the old policy, and it is in the new policy. I assume that, you know, that's the way it was done before. Yeah, right. But I'm a little concerned about the comment that was made that once the negotiation has occurred, then we're in, and the board is in a position of having to say yes or no to a compensation that has been communicated already to a candidate, if I'm understanding the process. So I'm wondering if there's something, and I totally agree with Trustee Garcia's comment that if there's going to be a deviation from the incumbent salary, and I remember that in the last five searches we never did deviate, that there should be an explanation, and we should be talking about it as a board, and whether it before it's communicated to the candidate, or at least the range that is being thought of as the right salary. It worries me a little bit on terms of process that the horse will be out of the barn. We'll all feel like, geez, we don't want to lose a good candidate by saying, oh, never mind, on the salary we just offered you. So I have concerns about that. I do think that prior to 2012, there was no limitation on an incoming president's compensation. It was left to our good judgment and discretion to stay within the boundaries of prudence and the budget, et cetera. That's the way it was up until 2012, when a recession, you know, changed our world. So having it revert back a little bit to the prior policy, where we are exercising our judgment each and every time, on behalf of this institution, which is our job and why we sit on this board, you know, that doesn't worry me at all. I think we're absolutely capable of making good decisions. But having the recommendation be made before we can even exercise that judgment worries me a little bit.
So, Chancellor.
Well, I want to thank all the trustees' comments, and I'd like to come back and address a few of the points that were raised. First off, the role of the president today is different than the role of the president was even 6 to 12 months ago. And I don't want the public or the board to have that moment lost. Just simply last 2 weeks. To give you a sense of the breadth and the depth of the expertise and the skill set and the commitment that these men and women provide to their campuses and their communities. From the deaths of students to the issues of inclusive excellence, to setting record year over year on fundraising, to dealing with their local politics, dealing with issues on campus that affect student success. Trustee Taylor, your point about the S on the chest, perhaps we should add as an obligatory part of their compensation that we do put a phone booth and a blue and red cape on every campus. I understand in America the concern about executives and how there has been a us versus we sort of conversation off and on over time. But these men and women are dedicated to the success of our students and our faculty and our staff and their communities. And so, as you pointed out so aptly, we play in a market, and that market is difficult for us. And you're right, there are places, particularly on the private side, but most publics as well, who can put a first, put a number in front of a potential presidential candidate that we would never feel appropriate in California to do. But mission, our mission only carries us so far. And so part of the reason for having a policy is to, on one hand, to the points that Trustee Fagan alluded to and others, of making sure to the public and to our elected leaders and to our faculty and staff that there is a governor, not in the sense of the Governor Brown, but a governor, a down regulator, a cap, if you will, on the kind of compensation we will consider. And that in and of itself means that some people who we contact at the front end of the process simply say, if that's going to be the outcome, then there's no point in us having a further conversation. And we do lose some interesting candidates at the very front of a process because they can't put themselves or their families in that sort of a position. And to their credit and to our credit, we weed them out early. The second thing is, so first of all, I wanted to say to our current presidents and to our future presidents that I, having been one, and I paying attention on a daily basis to the sort of increasing, exponentially increasing demands on our presidents, is that we would be ill-served to have any policies in place that don't allow us to recruit and appoint people who really matter for the success of this institution. The second thing is the wording in the policy that's in front of you is to give maximum flexibility to find those leaders that fit our needs. But to the point that you were raising, Trustee Taylor, is, you know, we don't necessarily want them to be, and Trustee Eisen, we don't necessarily want them to be leaders of national policy, because if they come out of an atypical background, they would never have had that opportunity. So we've tried to take out words that limit the pool without taking out the concept of looking for this extraordinary level of experiences and skills in a whole host of areas that can provide leadership in the current way of public higher education. Trustee Taylor, prior to your arrival to the board, there have been searches where we've had people not from the traditional background as finalists, and they've added to the richness of the conversation. But at the end of the day, they fell short, not because of where they came from, but where they fell short based on the trustee's decision as to what the best fit was for the campus. And we continue to look for people who come from non-traditional backgrounds in order to get that leadership. And then finally, I would say, I have to be careful how I say this, because I like being the chancellor. But if you don't have confidence in your chancellor to go out and to recruit a pool and to sit down with those individuals as we get close to decision time and negotiate within the policy for a salary, then quite frankly, we have a bigger issue. I need guidance from you as to what range I can work at. I will look at the circumstances. I will look at the means and the medians. I'll look at the competitors. I'll look at the knowledge base and the experience of the person we're trying to bring in. And from that quantitative analysis, we'll sit down and come up with a number that I think is within the policy and within our ability to recruit that individual. But you have to recall that when we get into this process of visiting the finalists with the trustees, that it is only about 70 hours later where we have that person announced. And if I don't have the business side wrapped up then, it's going to put us in an impossible position to say, you know, here's our new president, but they don't know what they're going to get paid. And depending on what that number is, they may or may not accept that job. It's impossible for them. It's impossible for me. It's impossible for the CSU. So if there's issues about your faith in your chancellor's ability to have the authority to negotiate recommended starting salaries within whatever policy you adopt, then we should have another conversation.
As much as I hate to, I'd like to add a couple of things to that. Just from a clarification standpoint, I think it's also worth reminding the board that Title V says the board must approve this. I would also remind you that, to your point, Trustee Eisen, about having a conversation in advance to see if that's a salary that we can do, by law, those conversations with the board can only occur in open session. And so there has to be some practical way for the chancellor to be able to have a conversation with a candidate about what a potential salary could be, subject to approval by the board, because the only time you can have a conversation as a board about those salaries is an open public session. There is no authorization for you under the law, under Bagley King, to have that conversation with the chancellor or with a candidate outside of that public session. So I want to make that very, very clear. Correct, Fram?
Trustee Stepanek, I'm sorry. Did you want to speak? Did you want to speak? Trustee Stepanek?
Yes, my question is, if this particular policy is approved, this is looking down the road, for those particular presidents that are currently receiving part of their overall compensation from the foundation, are we looking at a potential request coming to the board to in some way sweep that and make that so it's state funds?
Yeah, I think this is a looking forward policy. Trustee Stepanek, I don't think we had any, you know, I haven't contemplated any look back in that regard. To me, it's a go forward statement.
Trustee Farrar and then Trustee Kimball.
Yes, I just wanted to add to Becky's concern too about the trustees having information. There are trustees on each search committee whose job is, like we do with these committees here, to represent the board. So in effect, they do know, you know, it is not just the chancellor going out. I mean, anyone that's been on a search committee, you do have knowledge from the chancellor about the candidate's offer of salary. Just think that's a point.
Trustee Kimball, and then Trustee Garcia.
Yeah. I had a question. I feel like I'm missing something with the salary. With the policy as it exists now, potential candidates, don't they know exactly what they will be making?
No,
because if we hire somebody and they get the same salary as the predecessor, isn't that
No, Trustee Kimmel, that's actually not accurate. Under the current policy, there's freedom to negotiate up to a maximum. For example, if you have a long-serving president who's been in an institution 25 years and has been a president for that long, and you hire somebody who's just becoming a first-time president, you're not even going to give them the same salary, perhaps, that the incumbent has. Mm-hmm. There's a range of places along, frankly, you know, from almost zero to what that incumbent makes that are possible and that can be used. If you have somebody who comes in with an equivalent amount of experience, with an equivalent amount of background and skills that you want for the position, you can consider that up to that incumbent salary and up to 10% under the current policy. So there's no assumption that it has to be the existing incumbent's salary. That's a case-by-case decision that's made based upon each individual candidate's experience.
I understand. Okay, I understand that. But I've been on two, I haven't been on the search committees, but I've been here when we've hired two presidents. Mm-hmm. And it's my understanding we've offered them, I think, even we've offered them what the predecessor received, correct? Nobody received less mm-hmm. than the predecessor, just given the assertion that we're below median salaries anyway. Right, was there?
I do believe we hired one person in the last couple of years at less than the incumbent salary. I know that we hired one person at the incumbent salary.
Right. I think since I've been here, it's been two. So I just wanted to be clear on that. Given what we've been, the discussion about wanting to raise the cap and talking about how the salaries are not competitive, it would seem as though any candidates can be pretty certain that they will be receiving, we will be offering no less than the last president's salary. And just, you know, you can go online and just figure out how we feel about the salaries and, the comparison salaries. And that's just, my sense would be that they would be pretty, any candidates could be pretty secure in knowing that they will not be receiving less, I guess, than the position,
Always hard to be in a position to disagree with a trustee, but I will respectfully do so. I think as with every employee group we have in the system, there are ranges that have minimums and maximums. And in this case, you have a minimum of zero and a maximum of the incumbent's salary plus 10. We talk to all candidates, regardless of whether they're presidents, about what the possibilities are from, frankly, those minimums and maximums. And so the conversations with candidates throughout the presidential search process, they know what the policy is clearly, and that's a maximum outside. But I don't think candidates go in knowing absolutely that that's what they're going to receive. It's a very normal mm-hmm. compensation practice to have minimums and maximums.
Okay, thank you.
Trustee Abrego and Ms. Eisen, did you want to speak after that? Okay.
The chancellor raises a point, and I don't think it's about that we don't trust you. We absolutely trust you. The problem I have with this policy is that it really doesn't address the inequities that we currently have among all our presidents. In fact, it may compound the issue by bringing in someone new, making more money than a sitting president. And that's a big, big concern to me. Additionally, I think that when we talk about a 10% increase, particularly when we're facing impaction, the CFA and other competing interests, I'm not sure that it would be wise of us at this point to change the policy that we currently have by using state money for the additional 10%. I'm having difficulty justifying using additional tax dollars to supplement the president's salary.
Trustee Eisen?
Yeah, I echo what Trustee Abrego said. It has nothing to do with trust, and we absolutely trust our chancellor to make the best possible decisions for this institution. He always has, and I'm sure he always will. Now, my concern was that in the process, the search committee process, that there be some mechanism, and I understand limitations on what we can discuss outside of an open forum, but some discussion that would give the chancellor a sense, at least, of the search committee's thoughts on whether or not the candidates that we're looking at are candidates where we want to maybe go the extra mile, or candidates where we feel that they don't have necessarily the track. And that has been, as I recall it, the process in most of the searches. Anyhow, we all think about what kind of compensation is going to be appropriate and give the chancellor some, you know, at least thoughts about that to help him with the negotiations, so that when we do get to the board approval process, it's smooth, and there isn't, you know, concerns raised at that awkward stage. So that was the only point that I was trying to express.
If I could just comment, trying to think how to say this, I'm going to ask Fran Virgie to speak in a moment about the conflict of commitment, conflict of interest, and having more than one boss when there's more than just state dollars involved in supporting an employee. So when a candidate is interested in our position, as I mentioned earlier, some will immediately ask questions about, well, what's the possibility on compensation? And that's either with me if they're that level of a candidate, but more often than not, it's with the direction that we've given to our search consultant. And so that does weed out some people who we would like to actually have in the pool, but you know, they're thinking about $15 and we say the max is going to be $10, right? And they just say, you know, if that's not at all negotiable, then let's not waste anybody's time and move on. And that happens. So then we have a pool that we develop, and we get serious as time goes on, particularly after we've been on the campus and have had the vetting of the resumes with the campus community and with the trustees. We get down to typically six individuals that we will then meet in person for a more in-depth conversation. So once we get down to that number, it becomes appropriate for us to find out what is the person currently making, and where would the potential salary be for this particular presidency. So if somebody is a sitting president somewhere else and is making a number that's here, and we're talking about bringing them to a campus and the number is less than that, you know, we have an honest conversation about that at that point. Is the mission of the CSU sufficient to pay that difference in their mind's eye? Is the fact of being part of the greatest university system in America, living in California, are there family issues? There's a whole host of professional and personal issues where the person is in their career. Some are still in that mid-career building stage. Others have compensation becomes less important to them when they want to do the mission piece. So that's why the policy is written with such a degree of flexibility, is because we want to at that point tailor it down to the specific conversations. But when we go from six to three, I have to know, do we have any issues here that are going to exclude somebody? And so as we get down to the three, there are more detailed conversations with that individual about exactly what the compensation that I will be proposing to the board will be, and the basis of that. So somebody, for example, who may be their first presidency, but we think has all the skills that will ignite that campus in a new direction, but is replacing somebody who is very accomplished and long-serving, whose salary is higher, you know, then I would be bringing to you a salary recommendation below the incumbent's number, right? If, on the other hand, we have a campus where, for whatever reason, the current number is well below what the market is, and we have somebody who has a good set of experiences and exactly the right fit, but it's going to require more than the incumbents, then I'll bring that number to you. But what I can't do is have no knowledge of where the board's cap is. Not the norm, not the target, but the cap. And so if I have to bring a salary forward on an individual in our finalist pool that everybody wants to have as the president, and it's 8% above the incumbents, you know, if I have that conversation, it's within policy, there is indeed an expectation that we would be able to make that deal. Otherwise, you put the CSU's reputation and my, quite frankly, reputation for those individuals saying, well, he said one thing, but he actually couldn't deliver on that. That would be a very chilling outcome in the process of attracting and retaining presidents. So that comes back to the issue here of asking the board to set a cap, recognizing that I'm as cheap as anybody, and I will be bringing a very thoughtful presentation to you as to why this number is the correct number, looking at all of the variables that we look at when we make these sorts of appointments. I hope that, you know, so we're trying to get a policy that actually embraces the practicality of a confidential search when there is a short amount of time to go from a decision to appointment. And that's just the reality we're trying to get our arms around.
I would add that analysis will include, to Trustee Abrego's concern that he expressed, an analysis of what are the existing internal inequities and how can we continue to balance new hires within that scale of what's already happening within our system to make sure we're not continuing to perpetuate those.
And I wanted to ask Fran Verdi to comment a bit about the conflict issues. Fran.
Well, there is an inherent potential for an appearance of conflict, at the very least, when you have a situation where a foundation is providing compensation for a potential agreeing to provide compensation for an incoming president who will then be sitting on that foundation board and participating and making decisions about that foundation statutorily, regulatorily, and organizationally. Presidents of our campuses are appropriately involved in the running of our auxiliaries, including our foundations. And while I am very confident that they make great efforts to assure that there's no actual conflict of interest there, there is an appearance. And the last thing we want is for there to be an appearance of a conflict. And that is the problem.
Lori?
I just want to add to the conflict issue. We have all seen this play out two times in the year plus that I've been here, as we've done the modest increases with those presidents that have foundation side dollars. We have had lengthy debate about whether we're going to go to those foundations and ask for additional funds to do that increase, or do those on state dollars so that there's not a disparate treatment of the presidents who have those dollars, and asking those foundations at a time when those presidents actually sit on those boards to supplement the foundation side dollars for equity purposes is a real challenge and brings that conflict of interest even more to light.
And I might just, so we just run this piece of this policy down, ask Garrett Ashley to comment a little bit, because he's the one who speaks with the foundation chairs on the various campuses when we have these. And there's a range of abilities for large, mature campuses where the foundations are big and ongoing conversation than a small campus that is or a younger campus that hasn't yet built up their foundation. Garrett, would you mind commenting a little bit about that heterogeneity, which really ties to the equity of how we approach our presidents?
Sure. And I think you said most of it right there. Not all foundations in the system are the same. Not all foundation bank accounts are the same across the system. So if you only have one avenue with respect to your flexibility, you haven't run into the situation yet, but you could very likely run into the situation at some point where you might want that flexibility, but you're unable to implement it or do so because of the inability of the foundation to provide the differences. So in some cases, it's been a relatively easy conversation and simple. In others, it's been a little more challenging. We've always ultimately been successful and it's worked well, but I do worry about it ongoing.
I think, you know, from my perspective, taking into the comments of all of my colleagues, right? I think I was trying to make this as simple as possible. I think to Trustee Kimball's point, making it clear, there's only going to be one source of funds, right? We're going to take the foundation out of it, right? Doesn't mean it couldn't be an option, I suppose, theoretically, as Trustee Fagan said, but trying to be clear, it's going to be one source of funds. So it's, you know, where did the money come from? Then two, continue to give clear direction to this chancellor and to the public that there's a cap. It's very clear. This board was very clear at the last hearing. We're going to continue to have a ceiling, and I think we're trying to do that. And then three, and most importantly to this board, is to continue to invest the, you know, invest and secure the fiduciary responsibility and the decision-making authority with you, in consultation with your chancellor. And I think providing the maximum flexibility to attract the types of candidates that I think both Trustee Eisen and Taylor were referring to, but at the end of the day, having a process that ultimately stops at this dais with this board, and I think this policy achieves that.
Trustee Fagan, Trustee Taylor, and then Trustee Garcia.
I think we should be aware that in the scheme of things, obviously, the hard dollars we're talking about are not overwhelming compared to our overall budget. But that being said, we are talking about spending more tax dollars, and I don't think we should be taking that all that lightly. Not that we are, but we should be aware of that. And I think one of the things that is going to be a result of this, and I think Lou pointed this out, is that the first step is going to be, since new presidents won't be getting old presidents will no longer be foundation money. So we're adding tax dollars there. Then if we are looking at making it easier to offer 10% above the incumbent, and I suspect when we make it easier, it's going to happen. And when that happens, over a period of time, the disparity of the new president's salary with the existing president's salary is going to be ever more glaring. And I think we'll be asked in the not too distant future to correct that disparity. So I think down the road, we're looking at a slippery slope of increasing salaries all the way around. And then once the presidents get that, then is it fair to the vice chancellors and on down? Our presidents work really hard. They do a great job, and I, you know, quite frankly, think they deserve more than they're getting. They deserve everything. We have to operate, as we've told the faculty, within the constraints that we have, and we have to look at that. I had a conversation just this morning where a president told me he worked 26 days straight, not just at home, but going to events, representing the school, dealing with crises. That's the kind of thing that goes on every all the time for all of our presidents. And that's why they're successful. So, but I'm a little confused, and I need a clarification. It seemed to me that Trustee Eisen had, Becky, that you couldn't find that paragraph on the chancellor having this authority to negotiate the salary. Is that right?
I was looking at the May 2012 policy on page 2 of our materials, and I don't see it there, but it's my understanding that since that has always been the practice, it was just sort of added
I asked Lori specifically if that was in the existing, if that paragraph is not changed from the past policy, and you said it has existed in that form in the past policy exactly with no change. So what's the story?
Trustee Fagan, I understood your question to be the one that was in the board materials for this meeting, and the original board materials for this meeting include look on page 2 under executive compensation.
Okay. So what I was asking is that paragraph a change today from anything we've had before? And the answer is?
Which paragraph are you talking about, Trustee
Fagan? The paragraph about the chancellor's authority to negotiate the salaries.
In the published materials of the November 17, 18,
I wasn't asking that question. I'm asking, has that paragraph existed before? Has that authority been specified in past policy.
In the two past policies, which are also in material, that particular specific language was not included. It is in the proposed policy we put in the November
materials.
Well,
we scrapped that one, so why would I be asking about that?
Because at the last board meeting, in particular in response to comments by individuals and particularly Lieutenant Governor Newsom, he asked about the practicalities of how to address this. When we have an information item before the board, we hear we had a proposed policy, we heard the comments of the board, and our perspective was that to address some of the comments of the board about how the practical realities of implementing this occurred, that we tried to bring language to you in this version that would help address that, in particular by Lieutenant Governor Newsom. Okay. I went back and heard.
Trustee Fagan, I think the deficit maybe for you was the discussion we had at the last board meeting.
Well,
relates to making sure in the policy it's clear that we're defining the process as it exists today
I'm not even talking about that. I asked the question, is this a new paragraph in our policy? If we adopt this today, is this an added paragraph to the policy that we've never had in effect before? And
the answer is
I guess, is yes.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes.
I guess you misunderstood my question.
I absolutely did.
Okay. So I think we should, the chancellor's description of how this is going to go, I think is totally accurate. In that he's going to do the good faith negotiation within the parameters, the general parameters that he knows we have, and then he's going to come to a conclusion with that person and come back to us and say, this is what I did. It's going to be very, very difficult for us to say no at that point. So I just want to make sure we're all clear that this new paragraph that has never existed before is specifically ceding that authority to the chancellor. Now,
that is not a change in current practice, and I'll defer to my colleague, Trustee Farrar, who's been here longer than I have. But that is not a change in the practice of this board or the practical 70 hours from the time you make the appointment to the announcement.
I'm not objecting to that. What I'm saying is that maybe the practice, and it to some degree has, but I don't think we want to be in a position ever, unless it's a really gross experience, to contradict the chancellor's negotiating decisions. For all the reasons that he describes. So I just think it's important for us to realize, though, that this formalizes what has been a general practice.
To your point, absolutely. All I was referencing back was the discussion made light of that at the last discussion was, if that's the practice, right, it should be in policy, and that's being
right.
Staff's being responsive to that request. That's all I wanted to.
I guess my little bit of concern there is that it's nibbling away at our, perceived authority, and who's really in charge here.
I'm just gonna jump.
As we understand that, and we're.
Right.
Okay with it. Okay, it's fine.
I'm just going to jump in and say just a senior moment again for me, whatever we want to call it. As I do point out, we do have trustee authority like we do here on our committees. There are trustees on the search committee that will be made aware of that and still fall within the parameters of Bagley Keene. So, that is how we conduct the search. Blindsided to the trustees. It never has been, it never will be. And I think everybody's aware of that. We can't, just logistics, as the chancellor pointed out, offer a job to a candidate and then say, well, but I certainly hope the trustees will approve this. It's not practical. It's probably impossible. So I think if my colleagues agree, we are always aware of this too. And it is not just, there are trustees that represent the board on this, on each search, that will have already been okay with this.
Trustee Taylor and then Trustee Garcia.
So on the issue of inequity, the extent to which inequities exist now, if you don't allow flexibility, aren't we locking that inequity in forever? It would seem to me that allowing some flexibility gives the chancellor the ability to over time, as new presidents come in, narrow that gap between the highest and the lowest. Now, clearly, if he uses his authority to go the other way, we're in a position to put the brakes on that right here. But it would seem to me without that flexibility, those inequities are set in stone. And I don't think long-term that's a good thing. So I'm supporting this policy. You know, look, I would have tweaked some things here and there, but in the grand scheme of things, I think it's the right approach. And the chancellor is smart enough that over time, if he makes a bunch of bad decisions, he'll hear from us. Hopefully, that'll never happen.
Trustee Garcia.
Thank you, Trustee Morales. I guess just hearing all of the, one, I'm grateful that we're having the conversation and that we are addressing a number of questions that I'm sure others have as well. But I think I just kind of come back to my earlier comment about the guidance, because I what I'm hearing from the chancellor, and rightly so, is we need to trust in his authority and his decision making on finding what is the right compensation, whether it's right at the incumbent or somewhere below or somewhere above, with the cap being in place. But I, you know, someone told me, trust is good, control is better. And from my perspective, having those guidelines, I think, gives us as a board the assurance that when the chancellor is evaluating whether he's at incumbent above or below, he knows from us, he's heard from us what the guidance is. And so those parameters being extraordinary circumstances, I think that's pretty, sends a pretty clear message that we don't want to see this on a regular basis exceeding the incumbent. And I think when we say language like, you know, there is specific knowledge, experience that's going to bring something different to bear because this is a unique campus that needs something different, that those parameters are helping the chancellor know in advance, going into those negotiations, what the Board of Trustees is looking for and why we would be confident in supporting the chancellor in his negotiations, because we're all on the same page in terms of what we expect to see. And again, it's never going to be exact. But I think, you know, they say, I think this is also another famous frame, but freedom within a framework. So then you go within that framework using the judgment that you have, that you've always exercised, in my mind, absolutely appropriately in the way I would hope and expect. But I think giving that framework, it's not just for Chancellor White today, it's for the it's not for the board today, but for the board of the future. So I think that that level of control allows us to operate effectively as a board and trust our chancellor to work within that framework. So that's why, from my perspective, I do think we should have something more to help guide, and it creates consistency in the way we approach decision making. So that would be, my vote would be for us to, I support the policy. I just would want us to put a little bit more rigor around that framework to create clarity, not just for us, but for the chancellor, and to give him the opportunity to then exercise his judgment appropriately.
Trustee Kimball.
Thank you, Chair Morales. I wanted to start by saying thank you to Vice Chancellor Lamb for all your work on this. I think it definitely shows. Personally, I think that this policy is a good one. I think it allows for competitive recruitment and flexibility in terms of going after diverse candidates. It also recognizes that we ask a lot of our Superman and Superwoman presidents. And as a student trustee, having the opportunity to work with all of these different presidents, it's really opened my eyes to how integral they are to both student and campus success. But that being said, I don't represent myself or my thoughts. I have been asked to represent students throughout the CSU system. And when I met with student representatives from all 23 campuses, we spent some time this weekend talking about this policy. And while all of them were in favor of removing the foundation dollars component of this, none of them were in favor of removing the existing cap for this new one. My job is to represent students and to maintain their trust. So when this comes to the full board, I will be voting no. However, we have a problem in terms of equity and recruitment. And while this isn't perfect, this policy moves us towards a more manageable solution on this topic. So I just wanted all of you to have a student perspective before voting on this.
Trustee Kimball?
I appreciate all of the comments the trustees have made and the chancellor, and I want you to know that I trust you absolutely. But, you know, I feel as a trustee, I agree with what Lupe says, that, you know, trust and verify and trust. And I feel uncomfortable that perhaps with some of the language we are giving up the power and the responsibility that we have, perhaps. I've really spent a couple of sleepless nights wondering and worrying about this vote. I would love it if we could pay our presidents, who are amazing and work so hard, a lot more money. I wish we could pay our faculty a lot more money. I wish we could drop tuition. All that would be just fabulous. But we've heard in meetings that, just to quote somebody, the reality is that we are digging ourselves out of the recession. We were down $1 billion and we're only up, I think, $600 million. So we're still in that hole. I did a pros and cons on this, and definitely pro, you know, if we offer more money, we have a larger pool of candidates, and presidents are very important. My problem is this now, in light of the faculty concerns, the strike concerns, possible tuition issues, how we're going to, if we're going to have to raise tuition in the future. I mean, we don't know. We don't have a crystal ball. And just to go to what Doug said, I have not been on the board that long. I'm on a search committee now. I don't know that I necessarily believe we cannot find good presidents at current salaries. But that said, I'm willing, when I go through this process and I feel, boy, they're just, these candidates are not, you know, we deserve more, our students deserve more. I would absolutely be able to come back and say, you know, we need to revise this policy. So I think that, and I agree with Lupe's suggestion that we change the language. So I have to say that as it stands now, I cannot support it.
Sure, Monville.
Thank you. I think there are two other things that I would comment on. One, directly, in trying to balance Trustee Garcia's concern as it relates to rigor, and that of, I would say, you know, Trustees Eisen and Taylor, to continue to look at a broader pool. And I do think, frankly, the language that's before you here, individuals' reputation and length and depth, effectiveness of applicable experience and other meritorious achievement and contributions to the success of the institution, in this case, the CSU, does give the chancellor a direction from this board in that regard. So I would note that point with you. I think then secondarily, I would remind all of my colleagues, as I noted earlier in my comments, and we have taken care to consult with stakeholders in Sacramento, in particular the Department of Finance, who is comfortable with this policy as it's been submitted before you today. I would ask that you keep that in mind as you consider you're making your deliberations.
Other comments? Yeah, Ms. Eisen.
I have a question about the reference to the tiered list of CSU comparison institutions. I noticed that was in the prior policy and even the 2007 policy. And I understand, Lori, that it was the 2007 was derived from an institution that no longer exists. So what do we use now to compile this tiered list of CSU comparison institutions? And I mean, do we have that available to us as we go into these five searches, for example? All public institutions, I'm assuming they are, but.
Yes, Trustee Eisen, at the last board meeting, we presented information that included the list of tiered institutions. That information was included there. We have a list that is tiered for
a sort of our high enrollment institutions, medium enrollment institutions, low enrollment institutions. We select those institutions because CPEC no longer exists and does this sort of thing for us. We select those using different criteria, including student enrollment, including budgeted dollars, total amount of research, including Pell eligible, and including the six-year graduation rate, among others. What we do then is a search of the national databases for all public institutions. So they are all public institutions, generally master's degree granting institutions, like our own CSU institutions. So they're similar in mission. And we use them from the IPEDS database. We get that information and compare institutions across those criteria and select the ones that most consistently match our institutions in those criteria. And that's how that list was derived. The list was originally derived after CPEC went away, and then it was updated again in 2014 and reviewed again in 2014 to make sure that we're still staying consistent with changes across institutions nationally.
Ms. Garcia and then Ms. Norton.
So just one, just to clarify, I appreciate, Chair Monville, your comment about the fact that the language that's being proposed in the revised amended policy does state applicable individual reputation, et cetera. That's also applicable for all across all positions. But I think what I want to emphasize is the 10% above. So what I'm saying is we need criteria, again, the chancellor's negotiations. And so the criteria you're referencing is just generally for any position, because we're looking at this for across all levels. We're going to look at that. But when we say when we go above, when we do that 10% more, or when we consider more than the incumbent, it's not just the 10%. It could be 1% over incumbent, 2% over incumbent. When we are going to consider anything above the incumbent, that's where I feel that we are lacking guidance to give the chancellor that framework that he needs so that he can move forward without this concern that he's not going to have the support. Because what we want to do is set him up to be successful in these negotiations, and having that level of clarity up front specific to anything above the incumbent. That's where we're not currently having that. We don't have that criteria specifically stated, and that's where I feel we need the rigor. So just to clarify, it's not that I don't see it in the other paragraph, but it's specific to anything above the incumbent.
Trustee Norton.
I think I may be one of the few trustees who hasn't spoken yet this morning, and I don't want you to think that I've nodded off again. My understanding of my job as a trustee is to try to make decisions which serve the long-term interests of our students and of the university. And while I recognize that this is a very complex situation that runs in many different directions, there is no doubt in my mind that from the point of view of the long-term interests of the institution, going back to some of the things that Trustee Taylor has alluded to, that this is a policy which serves those long-term interests.
Other comments?
Some of the concerns expressed by a lot of the trustees seem to be things that maybe could be corrected or fine-tuned with a little bit of more time to examine this. Would it be possible to rewrite this and have a little bit added clarity and in some more, and bring it back to the board in January at a point when everybody would be more on board?
I think in the best of all possible worlds that would be great, but we have these searches going on, and my concern is that we need to make a decision today about this. As I said earlier, I totally agree with Lupe that we want to make the chancellor successful. We don't want him negotiating a salary and having us uncomfortable with it when it comes to us. But I think we've said those things loud and clear, and we have received back from the chancellor his total assurance and commitment that he is going to be reading from us what, in these search efforts, what we think is appropriate, and he's not going to be going out half crazy and coming up with something that he thinks is best, despite what the the suggestions from the search committee and the board members on the search committee has been. So I am totally comfortable that, and as Trustee Taylor says, you know, if a bunch of bad decisions get made, which I doubt will happen, you know, there is, we are the regulator. We can make sure that, you know, stops. So I'm happy with it as it is. It's not perfect. Nothing is perfect. And when you're talking about compensation in particular, you know, it is an extremely tricky subject. But I do agree with what everybody has said about the job that these presidents have and how tremendously complex and difficult it has become. And our students deserve the best we can give them and have given them in terms of presidencies. So I'm good with it for now, and for these five searches that we've coming up, I think we should vote on it.
I'll move the item as it's submitted.
Just for the record, want to agree that I believe the chancellor would never do anything half crazy.
Let me. Is there a motion you want to introduce? Questions. Yeah, and then after that we can have questions. Yeah,
yes.
Go ahead.
It has to be the committee, right?
Trustee.
He's on all the committees.
Chair Monville.
Lewis moved the item. I second it.
Oh, who moved it? Okay.
I second it.
Okay, second. Moved to second. Okay. Discussion, Lupe.
I guess from a process question, Fram, I know that in the past when we've had board meetings and conversations and we've wanted to amend something that's before us, because again, obviously this was amended. It wasn't part of our original board materials, but it's in front of us now. Is there a reason why we couldn't add the language from the materials that are in the board and adding that with respect to any increment above the incumbent and not have that as a amendment to the amendment, and then voting on that?
No, absolutely not. There's a motion on the floor right now. It's been moved and seconded. You could ask to amend the motion to approve that the document that's in front of you, and propose language to amend it. If that was seconded and then approved, that would be what would be brought forward. So you can propose language now.
I can do that at this juncture. Sorry,
yes.
I'm just asking procedurally.
Yes.
I don't want to miss it.
It can be. It doesn't need to be a committee member, correct?
I'm sorry. It needs. I'm mistaken. It has to be a member of the committee that does it here. It if you wanted to do it,
you'd be doing it at the committee
of the whole.
And let me repeat who the members are of this committee. It's myself, Abrego, Farrar, Kimball, Taylor, the chancellor, and our chair.
Okay. So then I will. My position would be to do it at the plenary. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, any more comments from members of the committee?
I just want to make sure I know what I'm voting on. We're basically adopting the same policy that we'd have in the past, except we're waiving the where the source of funds comes for the 10%, correct?
That's the kind of the bottom line. Plus, we're also, there's language that's been pointed out in this discussion that was not in the prior, the current policy.
That is correct. And the language that Trustee Morales refers to is what captures the chancellor's practice and ability to negotiate and work on behalf of the board, as we've been discussing.
That's right. And the interpretation of that, I think, was very well summarized by, from my vantage point, from Trustee Eisen. Okay. So do we have a vote of committee members?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Other, should we say aye?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, there's one opposed. These are just committee members.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, it's one. Oh, two opposed. So why don't we have a show of hands? Okay, just for clarification.
How about a roll call vote?
Okay, a roll call vote.
Okay?
Yeah.
Roll call vote. Mr. Morales?
Yes.
Mr. Abrego? Ms. Farrar?
Yes.
Ms. Kimbell?
No.
Mr. Taylor?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Chair Monville, this concludes the business of this committee.
Thank you. We're a little bit behind schedule, so in In deference to my colleagues, I'll give you all a 5-minute break, and then we will reconvene the Committee on Institutions in about in 5 minutes, five till. Am I reading that right? I'm sorry, quarter of. Thank you.